When I think of the most technically impressive Unreal Engine 5 releases, the finals always comes to mind. But now Embark Studios are back with another strong contender, one that's even more ambitious. This is Ark Raiders, a third-person extraction shooter built on Unreal Engine 5. Like with the finals, Embark has done extensive custom work on the engine to address UE5's well-known performance issues. On top of that, the game runs on Nvidia's branch of Unreal Engine 5. One of the most notable differences this brings compared to the standard UE5 build is the complete omission of virtual shadow maps, Lumen, and consequently Nanite. Instead, the game relies entirely on Nvidia's RTX GI or DDGI for global illumination, which is a probe-based solution that leverages hardware ray tracing to deliver fully dynamic real-time diffused and direct lighting. And when looking at the game's performance, these changes clearly paid off. Ark Raiders runs exceptionally well compared to other recent UE5 releases, with low VRAM usage and mostly stable frame times. And I say mostly because at its core it's still an Unreal Engine 5 game, and achieving a perfectly flat frame time graph in large open environments with this engine is practically impossible. On the visual side, the game looks great most of the time, and the gorgeous art direction does much of the heavy lifting. That said, it's not perfect. Upon closer inspection, you'll notice some visual issues, such as light leaks and artifacts or LOD pop-in, that could have been mitigated with Lumen or Nanite. Still, I'd take a game that looks like this over any stuttery, poorly optimized one that insists on using every demanding UE5 rendering features, regardless of the performance cost. When it comes to the user interface, Embark have done an excellent job here as well. The graphics menu is clean and well designed, and during gameplay it becomes transparent, allowing you to see the visual changes in real time. However, it would have been even better to include preview images and an option to hide the detailed graphics descriptions, since they occupy a large portion of the screen and can make it harder to see how each setting actually affects the visuals. And overall, the menu doesn't offer a lot of settings, but since this is still a UE5 game, there is plenty of room to squeeze out extra performance from what's available. But before we dive into that, let's first examine image quality and the upscaling options. In this section, I also want to cover the post-processing setting, as it significantly affects image stability. Now, this setting, as usual, controls several effects, like depth of field, which becomes noticeable during gameplay when using Epic. It also adjusts other post-processing effects, like bloom, sun glare, and most importantly, ambient occlusion, which is completely disabled on low, as you can see here. In terms of performance, this setting has a noticeable impact, around a 9% cost when moving from low to high or epic. But the real issue here is the poor quality of ambient occlusion, which makes the foliage look noisy and grainy, as you can see here. And it gets even worse when using FSR3 or XeSS compared to DLSS, TSR, or even the standard TAAU. And I know this is an ambient occlusion issue, because if we set post-processing to low while using the DLSS transformer model, which exhibits more flickering than the CNN model, and we'll talk about that shortly, we can see that the noise is no longer noticeable, though everything looks flatter without any ambient shading. Now let's talk about the image quality of each upscaler. Here, when using the quality mode at 1440p, DLSS CNN delivers the best overall image quality, as expected. FSR3 struggles significantly with screen space shadows, especially on foliage, resulting in noticeable flickering and shimmering. TAAU offers the best performance, but the hit to image quality isn't worth it. I recommend avoiding it. Finally, TSR and especially XeSS provide a more stable and cleaner image compared to FSR3 and TAAU. There is also an anti-aliasing setting, which affects the quality of both TAAU and TSR. For TAAU, Epic delivers a noticeably more stable image than low, with no measurable performance impact. For TSR, however, the performance hit is more significant, as you can see here. Despite that, the image quality differences between the anti-aliasing levels with TSR are extremely subtle and difficult to notice. So if you're using TSR, I recommend keeping this one at low or medium. Last but not least, we have the DLSS4 transformer model. As mentioned earlier, when it comes to ambient occlusion, DLSS CNN looks more stable than the transformer model, as you can see here. But that's not the whole story. The transformer model has several other issues. For example, particles tend to leave noticeable trails, especially in volumetric heavy areas like this one. On the other hand, the CNN model is more stable and doesn't suffer from this issue. DLSS transformer also shows some fizzling and breakup on volumetric effects on certain scenes like here. But of course, when it comes to motion clarity, it looks significantly sharper compared to the CNN variant, though this comes at a performance cost. Overall, given the visual drawbacks, I find it hard to recommend the transformer model, and in my opinion, the CNN model is the better choice. Next, we have NVIDIA RTX Global Illumination. Using static disables dynamic lighting and falls back to pre-calculated lighting instead. Setting it to low or medium enables ray tracing, which improves ambient shading and bounce lighting. However, as you can see, some elements like the weapon are not covered by the GI and end up looking glowy. Switching to high significantly increases precision and coverage, fixing the incomplete shadowing. And going further to epic adds slightly more bounce lighting. That said, RTX GI has one visual drawback, light leakage, which is a known limitation of probe-based lighting. Performance-wise in this scene on the 3060 Ti, there is about an 8% cost when going from static to dynamic low or medium, around 13% when going to dynamic high, and roughly 30% when going to dynamic epic. Also keep in mind that this is hardware ray tracing, so the performance impact can vary depending on your GPU. If you have a GPU with weak ray tracing capabilities, I recommend keeping this on static. Otherwise, if you want to enable ray tracing, dynamic high is the best option. Moving on to view distance. This setting controls the draw distance and LOD of objects in the game, including foliage, trees, rocks, etc. Low and medium exhibit noticeable pop-in compared to high and epic, as you can see here. Performance-wise in this scene, there is a 4% cost when going from low to medium, 8% to high, and 14% to epic. So since there is no nanite here to help with LOD pop-in, I recommend leaving this one at high or epic. Let's move on to shadows. As usual, this setting adjusts the filtering quality and draw distance of the game's shadow maps. Low can disable many shadows in the scene, while switching to medium and higher enables those shadows and improves their softness. Performance-wise, there is a 4% cost when going from low to medium, 8% to high, and 12% to epic. So for this one, I recommend medium or high. Next, we have texture. This one primarily affects the quality of anisotropic filtering. And generally, it does not significantly impact overall texture quality, as it mainly adjusts the allocated VRAM for texture streaming. Speaking of texture streaming, I noticed an issue with it, especially on Epic. Some textures load much slower, leading to more pop-in compared to high, as you can see here. And since this game doesn't use any of UE5's advanced features, VRAM usage remains modest even on Epic. However, because of the pop-in issue, I recommend keeping this setting at high. Moving on to effects, and this one impacts many visual elements. It affects the quality and level of bumpiness on the terrain, with high and epic showing better ground detail compared to low and medium. It also affects sky rendering, particularly volumetric clouds, as you can see here. When it comes to generated particles and special effects from weapons or explosions, there isn't a large difference between low and epic. The same applies to environmental particles like rain, where the difference between the options is not significant. Performance-wise, this is one of the most demanding settings when set to epic. Going from low to high comes with around a 6% cost, but epic has a much larger 22% performance hit. So for this one, I recommend avoiding epic and keeping it at high. Next, we have reflections. This one adjusts the quality of screen space reflections. Low disables SSR completely, leaving only the cube map fallback visible. Medium enables SSR, and going higher slightly improves the accuracy. Performance-wise, SSR is not demanding. It can range from no cost in scenes like this to around a 4% cost in others, as shown here. Therefore, I recommend keeping this one at epic. Let's move on to foliage. This setting controls the density of ground foliage and elements such as grass, bushes, rocks, pebbles, etc. Surprisingly, it doesn't have a large performance impact. There is only about a 4% drop when going from low to epic. But keep in mind that lower foliage density can provide a visibility advantage in certain situations, making it easier to spot other players hiding behind bushes. Normally in a game like this, this setting shouldn't be exposed and foliage rendering should be unified for everyone. So if you prioritize visibility and don't mind lower foliage density, keep this at low. Otherwise, high is a good balance between visuals and gameplay fairness. Finally, we have global illumination resolution. Here at this scene, going from low to high doesn't show a significant visual difference. Only with Epic we can see a noticeable improvement to the precision of the lighting. Performance-wise outdoors, the setting has a minimal impact, around 4% between low and Epic. Indoors, however, the cost rises significantly, about 5% from low to high and 13% when going up to Epic. So for this one, I recommend medium or high, and only use Epic if you have enough performance to spare. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for ARC Raiders. Now let's compare the optimized settings using high ray tracing against the Epic preset using Epic ray tracing, with both running at 1440p with DLSS CNN quality. Starting with the Praxis range map, we can see that the optimized settings deliver an average of around 42% performance improvement. Let's switch to the Damn Battlegrounds map, and interestingly, here we can see the same 42% performance gap consistent with the Praxis range map. However, here in the Blue Gate map, at least in this scene, the gap narrows slightly to around 37%, which is still a significant improvement. Finally, a quick look at how the optimized settings compare against the Epic preset without ray tracing while using DLAA instead of DLSS. And we can see on average around 35% when going from the Epic preset to the optimized settings. Before ending the video, I want to give a quick shout out to my Patreon. If you are able and would like to directly support my work, consider becoming a patron to get access to the highest possible quality of my latest videos, including this one. And a big thank you to all my supporters, and thanks to you as well for watching until the end. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.